Now we are to study Riemann integration and power series. See here, first we will see Riemann integration. See the definitions and existence of the integral. What is the idea behind Riemann integration? See here. Suppose this AB is a closed interval. This interval is given to us. And we will make a partition of this interval. By partition of AB, we mean a finite set P of points, x0, x1, x2, so on, xn. So this interval AB is partitioned by these points, n plus 1 points, where x0 is your starting point, small a, and xn is your last point, small b. So a is equal to x0 less than or equal to x1 less than or equal to, and so on, less than or equal to xn minus 1 less than or equal to xn is equal to b. So this is our partition of this closed interval AB. Now you can see here very clear that it has n plus 1 points. So similarly, we can, since we have no given any particular values to x0, x1, x2, so on, xn, it means we can have any number of partitions of this closed interval AB. Later on, we will consider all possible partitions of this AB and we will derive some theorems and results. Now for this partition x0, x1, x2, so on, xn, we have intervals, several intervals, or you can say closed intervals, x0, x1, x1, x2, so on, xi minus 1, xi, and so on, xn minus 1, xn. So this is a total of n intervals, or you can say here, these are n sub-intervals of this closed interval AB. So next, see, we use the symbol, this delta xi, this symbol is used for this sub-interval and also for xi minus 1. So the same symbol is used for both these expressions. It means delta xi is equal to xi minus 1. It is the width of this interval for I is equal to 1 to so on n. Now, the function f is assumed to be bounded and real valued on this closed interval AB. So the f is bounded. And since all of them are real numbers, we also assume that f is a real valued function. Since f is bounded in this closed interval AB, so it will be bounded in all its sub-intervals for any partition P. So this f will be bounded in this xi minus 1 xi also. Suppose capital MI and small MI, these are the supremum and infimum of f in delta xi. What does it mean? It means the maximum value of f in delta xi is capital MI and the minimum value of f in delta xi is small MI. Now we will make two sums. This is your UPF. U stands for upper, PFP stands for partition, and f is your function. UPF, this is equal to summation I is varying from 1 to n capital MI delta XI. So multiply this capital MI with this delta XI. Delta XI means this one, XI minus XI minus 1. So since I is varying from 1 to n, so it can be written as for the various values of I, M1 delta X1 plus M2 delta X2 plus 1 plus MN delta XN. So this is your capital UPF. Now LPF, L stands for lower, P is your partition and F is your function. So it is equal to summation I is varying from 1 to 1. Now this is small MI delta XI. As earlier, it can be expanded as M1 delta X1 plus M2 delta X2 plus 1 plus MN delta XN. This one is called upper sum of F corresponding to partition P, or lower sum or Darboux sum of F corresponding to partition P. And this one is called lower sum of F corresponding to this partition P, or Darboux sum of M corresponding to this partition P. If capital M and small m are the bounds of F in this closed interval, means in this interval, closed interval AB, capital M is the greatest value of F and small m is the least value of F in this bigger interval AB. So small m will be less than or equal to each mi, small mi, and this each mi is less than or equal to capital mi, and this capital mi is less than or equal to capital m. So all small mi and capital I, this will lie between small m and capital m, because small m and capital m are lower bounds and the upper bounds of F in this closed interval AB. Now multiply with delta xi. So it will be m delta xi less than equal to mi delta xi less than equal to capital mi delta xi less than equal to capital m into delta xi. Now substitute I is equal to 1 to so on n and add all the inequalities. Then what will you have? You will have m into b minus a less than or equal to LPF. This will be c, this will be summation over I m, I is equal to an mi delta xi. So this is your LPF. And if you take summation here, this will be your UPF less than or equal to capital M into b minus a. B minus a, b is the highest value in this closed interval AB, and a is the smallest value in this closed interval AB, where it is given that b is greater than or equal to a. So we have obtained this inequality. Now see, each partition gives rise to a pair of sums. For each partition, we have this LPF and this UPF, the upper and the lower sums. Consider all partitions of AB, then you will get a set U of upper sums. Upper sum means set U will contain UP1F, UP2F, UP3F, and so on. And L and the L, a set L of lower sums means this L will contain LP1F, LP2F, LP3F, and so on for partitions P1, P2, P3, and etc. So this inequality one shows that both these sets will be bounded, because UPF has some maximum value and LPF has some minimum value. So both of them are bounded. And so each set has the supremum and infimum. Means U will have supremum and infimum, and this L will have supremum and infimum. Now see, the infimum means minimum value of the infimum of this set of upper sums. We have made a set U of upper sums. So take the minimum of those, means take minimum of UP1F, UP2F, and so on, UPNF, and so on, etc. Take the minimum of those, that will be your called infimum, or you can say it is your upper integral. And see the set of lower sums means L. This will have LP1F, LP2F, LP3F, and so on. And take the maximum value or the supremum of this set of lower sums. It will be called as lower integral of F over this closed interval AB. Now, we write integral from A to B with an upper bar F dx is equal to infimum of U. Means U is our set of upper sums. Take infimum of those upper sums. So this will be your upper integral AB F dx, or infimum UPF, such that P is a partition of closed interval AB. And lower integral, integral from A to B F dx, lower bar is equal to supremum of L. Supremum of L means the maximum values of all lower sums for partition P. So this is equal to supremum L PF, such that P is a partition of closed interval AB. These two integrals may or may not be equal. We will later on see that when these two integrals are equal, then the function is said to be Riemann integrable. Otherwise, it is not Riemann integrable. See definition. This is Darboux's condition of integrability. Sometimes you will find that this is Riemann conditions of integrability. When the two integrals are equal, see, when this upper integral a to b f dx is equal to lower integral a to b f dx, then we write a common symbol for them, integral from a to b f dx. So we say that f is Riemann integrable. If that condition is satisfied, then the function f is said to be Riemann integrable. or simply integrable over closed interval AB, and the common value will be called Riemann integral of f over closed interval AB. We write it in symbolic as f belongs to this R closed interval AB, or simply f belongs to R. See your first inequality one. So from that, small m into b minus a is less than equal to integral from a to b f dx less than equal to capital M into b minus a, where b is greater than or equal to a. So the upper and lower integrals are defined for every bounded function, but they may not necessarily be equal for every bounded function. We have some functions for which these two integrals are not equal, and such functions are called not integrable. See here, sometimes we omit the limit of integration and simply write this as integration, upper integration a to b, lower integration a to b, and simply integration f dx when it is not necessary to write a and b. It is when it is clear, so we don't write. Now see some remarks. The statement integration from a to b f dx exists. It implies that this function f is bounded and integrable over this closed interval a b. This function, first, for this integration to exist, the function f is bounded and the integral should be finite. A and b, both of them should be finite. So from 1 and 2, when b is greater than a, see this is your 2, and from on earlier way it was 1 inequality 1. When b is greater than a, m b minus a less equal to LPF less equal to integration from a to b f dx less equal to UPF less equal to capital M into b minus a. See remark 4. Since the upper integral is the greatest lower bound, upper integral is greatest lower bound of the set of upper sums. Take the set of upper sums and take infimum. Infimum is greatest lower bound. So upper integral is that infimum. Therefore, for any epsilon 1 greater than 0, we will have an upper sum for partition P1 such that UP1F is less than integration from A to B, upper integral F dx plus epsilon 1. And similarly, LP2F will be greater than the lower integral from a to b f dx minus epsilon 2. Here we have added epsilon 1 and here we have subtracted epsilon 2. When we have subtracted, so we can find a partition P2 for which LP2F is greater than this one. And for this epsilon 1, we can find a partition P1 for which a UP1F is less than integration from a to b bar means upper integral f dx plus epsilon 1. See, remark 5, UPF minus LPF is written as summation over I capital MI delta XI minus summation over I small MI delta XI. So it can be written as summation over I capital MI minus small MI delta XI. Now, we will capital MI minus MI small MI. It is the oscillation of F in this subinterval delta XI. Means the maximum value of f in delta xi is capital MI and its minimum value is small MI. So take their difference, it will be called as oscillation. UPF minus LPF is called the oscillatory sum and we denote it by WPF, and it will be definitely non-negative because it is non-negative. So this is all about for today. In our next class, we will see some of the examples and solve them. Till then, you just study, and if you missed anything, you can go to my YouTube lecture. It will be uploaded on YouTube after 5 p.m. You can see this. Till then, goodbye.